Hello, Birmingham, Birmingham. Shall we begin? Wow, yeah, it's nice to be at a UK convention. I haven't really gotten to do too many of these. I've worked a couple of small ones, but this is the first time I've been in sort of one of your major cities doing a convention, so it's nice to be here. You know, I never got into this industry because I wanted to be famous or anything like that. You know, I got into it because I came from a steel city called Newcastle in Australia. You know, I was in a terrible car accident when I was a teenager. My mother and brother were both killed. So I kind of understand a little bit of struggle in life. And, you know, because of these things that happened to me happened when I was like 15 years old, it meant that my academia, you know, my academics, I wasn't a dumb kid, but, you know, it was difficult to try to keep concentrating on the blackboard at school when I knew my mother and brother had just passed away. So I had to deal with life more on an emotional level and a physical level. So I got into rugby. You know, I played rugby. You know, I made the Australian schoolboy team.
Wow.
You know, and yeah, so I got really big and played rugby, and that was the way of my physical way of dealing with what I went through. But then in order to deal with the emotional side of what I went through, my girlfriend was a ballerina. So she got me into ballet. And it was kind of like a Billy Elliot kind of story, you know. Because I missed out on playing at the Australian Championships. I was meant to go to the Australian Championships for rugby, and I couldn't go because I had to dance in Swan Lake. Which, you know, but, you know, something like that was kind of like a pivotal time in my life, because I knew there was two sides of who I was that was pulling at me. One of them wanted to express myself physically, and the other one wanted to express myself emotionally. So when I create characters, whether it be Crixus or whether it be Slade Wilson, Deathstroke, you know, I'm trying to find all there is to a man. I'm trying to find not just the camera angle to make my jaw look like some kind of Hollywood actor. I'm trying to find the thing that's in here that makes people feel the character. So, you know, I think Slade Wilson's kind of popular because, and also in the DC comic book world, because his moral approach, or his approach to the things that he does that would otherwise call him a villain, still has a degree of truth to it. Like in the Teen Titans, his son is killed by the Teen Titans. So as a matter of revenging or staying true to his bloodline, you know, he commits himself to pick up the contract that his son had. So there's all of this kind of you know, almost Shakespearean tragedy going on. And, you know, on the island in the television show Arrow, I had no idea how they were going to twist the story to make Slade go to the other side. But, you know, I kind of put my foot in it when I suggested that maybe there was a love triangle between, you know, Shadow and Oliver and Slade. And so they went, Manu, you know, you suggested that we're gonna do that, and we're going to make this the way that you guys fall out. But it was an interesting way to do that, because at the end of the day, it was the compassion that Slade had for Shadow. It wasn't like Slade was, you know, oh, I'm going to pick up this girl, you know. He sort of just sat there and kind of watched her, and I think the audience thought, oh, right, he feels for her, and obviously he's watching Oliver have the romance, and there was almost this degree of kind of like, well, and, you know, I didn't jump onto the idea of being some sleazy old guy, even though I felt that way with the way the storyline went. But, you know, it just sort of had a side to it that I tried to work so that it looked like it was something just honest and not something, you know, twisted.
Yeah.
But then the Mirakuru brought that kind of element into it. And it was interesting playing the Mirakuru, you know, because I just played as though it was alcohol or as though it was drugs, you know, where it would bring out rage. You know, and these are true human elements, you know, and they exist. And, you know, you go out there, you know, anybody who abuses substances, you know, they turn into monsters themselves. So it was becoming the monster of Slade. But you see, I think the thing is that the audience realized that Slade didn't take the Mirakuru. Oliver gave it to him in the first place to try to keep him alive. And there was this kind of like to-ing and fro-ing of what's going on here. Is it is Slade the really that bad guy? And I'm glad that was created as a certain question mark, because that's the way it exists in the DC comic book world. You just never know, you know. Slade's like almost like this very dark hero. So, and being able to base it upon not superpowers and stuff like that, but trying to just keep it within the human realm of feeling is where I try to find that truth. Spartacus was really something else. I mean, how many Spartacus fans in here? Yeah, it was an incredible journey. You know, everybody involved in that show did such amazing jobs. You know, right from the costume department. I mean, we really should have been nominated for some Emmys. The problem with the Emmys is that unless you're an American company, you can't vote. Like, unless you're actually registered in SAG and all these other guilds, you can't actually vote for the Emmys. And the way that most shows get their votes is the actual cast and crew and everybody involved in the production will vote for it. We actually met the lady from the Emmys when we went to one of the parties in LA, and she told us this. She said, your show really should have got some nominations, you know, because it was such a great portrayal of the time. But every time I picked up a script for Spartacus, I was really blown away by how well written they were. I mean, I can't say that there's any other show that I've worked on where the scripts even begin to compare with how good the Spartacus scripts were as a read, just to read them. But it was, you know, it was a huge, you know, misfortune for our show, and even a bigger tragedy for Andy Whitfield's family when Andy contracted cancer. But it was like one of these life reality things, you know, where I think all of the fans of the show even felt more deeply about the journey of our show. Some people did stop watching the show after Andy passed, just because they respected him that much. But those who did follow on, our writers and our production team, and I had to take a little bit of the mantle in terms of continuing the through line of especially the Spartacus Crixus and the Navier Crixus storyline, even though both characters were recast in the second season, you know. But they did a great job at keeping that story on a continuum, because even the CEO of our network wanted to cancel our show after Andy was diagnosed. And it was only between the good writing of Stephen DeKnight and the money people at Stars who said, well, why would we get rid of this show? It's doing very well for us. So they kept us going, yeah. Comic book character, wow. I think I got the character I wanted to play. I don't know, brother. To be honest, maybe Phantom, but I don't know. You know, look. I'm actually, you know, I think because of my ethnicity, you know, and some of my own truths, I'd like to be involved in some characters that might be dragged out of the Polynesian side of the world, you know, because we've got our own mythology and our own stories and our own wonderful history, and I'd love to be able to represent that sometime, you know. They're valuable stories as well, you know. I think we've been sort of umbrellaed by the Hollywood system for a long time, and I think that it'd be nice to be able to hear different stories from around the world. I think it'd help in a lot of ways these days. Well, there's a guy called Te Kōti. Te Kōti was a Maori leader who was trying to work against the taking of the land. And so him and a whole bunch of his guys were taken out to an island, the Chatham Islands. And when they were out there, they, like Spartacus, managed to overtake the prison where they were being held and escape and get on a boat and come back to New Zealand. And then they tried to come back through New Zealand trying to win the territory back. Unfortunately, they didn't make it. The same as Spartacus Spartacus, but it's like a Maori version of that story. And his name was Te Kōti. But my own great-great-grandfather was also the chief of our tribe. He was like Sitting Bull, or, you know, one of these chiefs. I'm trying to give you a reference. So if you want, who's got some internet on their phone? If you look on your phone, you can see my great-great-great-grandfather from New Zealand, my Maori ancestry. And his name is Pokiha. P-O-K-I-H-A. If you've got a phone, type that in. P-O-K, like POC, like Pokemon. P-O-K-I-H-A. Iha. Pok-Iha. Pok-Iha. If you look on your phone, you'll see my great-great-great-grandfather. And he was an incredible warrior as well. So, you know, there's some stories in the past that, you know, would be amazing to make of him. But he's not as famous as Te Kōti. Te Kōti and some other stories in New Zealand. But then there's the story of Maui, you know, and Kupe, who sailed around Polynesia in the way back in the day. They're interesting as well. I don't affiliate myself with probably a lot of the models for this type of heroism comes out of modern mythology that's come out of America, that's come out of systems, that's come out of a certain way of, you know. And I'm a New Zealander, and I'm a New Zealand Maori. My grandfather's Scottish. One of my other great grandfathers is Irish. I might even have some Jewish through a great great grandmother. And I don't know. You know, there's consequentially, I kind of liked Nanu. This very very old story. I think Bruce Jenner played this guy that could run really fast and came out of a jungle and kind of had a lot of natural, real skills. I don't know, brother. I'm hoping we're going to get some heroes in the real world soon. Yeah, you know. I mean, you know, and we've really got to grasp at stories. Stories kind of like one of the benchmarks of how we grow, you know. Art is such a great reflection on society, you know. And you know, it's the time's no greater than now to look for heroes. That's for sure.
As a dancer myself, I was wondering what your favourite parts and aspects of dance were, and how you've sort of brought it to your acting.
Well, because I'd lost my mother, and I was yearning for that female contact, I was very good at pas de deux. You know, my, and this is, I'll make this comparison. There was one other guy that I danced alongside at the Stedfords, and he was very mechanical, but very good, technically very good. But to this day, and he ended up in the Australian Ballet Company, you know, as a principal dancer, and his technical side of it is just amazing to watch him, you know. But I knew I could feel, and I knew my difference between him and me was when I was with somebody, if it was the expressions, and that's why I ended up sort of jumping out of dancing into the acting realm, for better or for worse. I don't know, you know. Like there's elements of every art form. I think if you choose, it's got its pros and cons. But you know, the dancing. I mean, I loved it. I was never more fit. And healthy than when I was doing my dancing. That was just, you know. But the girl that I used to dance with, her name was Jane Finney. She went on to become a principal dancer for the Australian Ballet as well. So if I'd stuck at it, I probably could have got there. But, you know, I got from it what I needed at the time. It was the thing that gave me 2 or 3 years of dancing with female energy, you know, and that helped me get through that time that I was going through with the loss of my mother. Yeah. Plus it's a little bit like the Black Swan, my studio. we had some pretty bitchy ballet mums and some pretty interesting scenarios going on that I kind of went, you know, I don't know whether I can stay in this confined space for so many hours every day with this going on, but maybe that was just my studio. You know, it's the interesting thing about Shannara is playing a protagonist, you know, where the energy that I'm letting out as a signal through that little square to you guys and a screen is actually all positive. You know, it might be negative because I have to play the layers of Al-Anon, where Al-Anon's tortured by the past, you know, and is almost, he's very tired of knowing the nature of the world, you know, and so that weariness is a dark layer, but essentially everything that he does is for the good. And you know, having played like Crixus, and when I first started playing Crixus, I really played him toward a side of the audience appeal where they'd hate him. As a matter of fact, my producer came up to me about three episodes into Spartacus, and he said, "What are you doing to the character? Have you read the online comments? People hate Crixus." And I'll tell you the reason why I played him like that. I think it's good to understand that your hatred can be turned around. When I was in the car accident with my mother and they were killed, I had an enemy at school. At my high school, there was one guy who just hated me. And I didn't really know why he hated me, but he had like a mullet haircut, and he wore death metal t-shirts, and he was angry all the time. At the same time, I had a flat top. I wore gel in my hair. I'd started to do some dancing, some ballet dancing with my girlfriend. You know, this guy hated me. And when I was in the car accident, I was in a coma for a week, unconscious. And when I woke up from the coma, this guy was standing next to my bed, my worst enemy. And he put his hand on my shoulder and he said, "You okay?" And like this eye, the scars that I've got on my face, people ask if they're makeup. They're not. I got them getting thrown out of the vehicle. When in the car crash, I was thrown out one of the side windows, and then I hit the road, and I was lucky to survive. But this eye was all closed, and I'm looking at this guy going, you know, what is my worst enemy doing here at my bedside, you know? And then the next day, I found out that my mother had passed away, and he was there the whole time. And then I found out that his mother had passed away when he was a kid. And it was through adversity that we suddenly realized we had a common bond. And him and I became best friends. And I was best man at his wedding. And I met up with him in New York about 4 weeks ago, 5 weeks ago. And him and I are like this. And, you know, whether it be Slade and Oliver or Crixus and Spartacus, you know, I've always tried to play this ability to go in there as hard and as negatively as you can. And then if you can transform all those negative feelings right through and to create kind of like a full picture of what people are, then this is the kind of journey that I try to take with my characters, you know? But that was the idea of taking Crixus through to that and Spartacus through. But with Alan on, it's interesting because he's really just trying to take experience and try to pass that on to some young people. And like being a father myself with three kids, I kind of understand now some of that empathy that's needed for that, even when you're completely frustrated. You know, you've just got to sit there and persevere, and you know, you can lose it. And like on screen, I can lose it. It's great. It's good to find, you know, try to be like reality and lose it with frustration, but then come back to trying to, you know, be mature and that's the thing about Al-Anon. But he's still got this little bit, you know, the way that Terry Brooks wrote him, he's still got this nature where he has to manipulate things in order to get what he wants in the end. And I try to play that with the way that Terry Brooks, you know, meant for that element of the character to be. Yeah. I think there's going to be more of that in the second season, which we start in February. Well, in Spartacus, I think right from the get-go, I mean, I prepared physically for Spartacus, unlike anything I'd done in my life before. I'd actually been up for a film prior to Spartacus called The Smashing Machine, where I was going to play like a mixed martial arts guy, an MMA guy called Mark Kerr. And I put on so much size for this particular role because this guy's character, he was, has anybody heard of Mark Kerr? When cage fighting first started in America, there were very little rules. and this guy called Mark Kerr, who had lost his mother and become like an American wrestling champion, became one of the top names in cage fighting. And he was a very convoluted character, and his character was so interesting that I really wanted this role when I... And the strange thing about it, I'm going completely off track here, but this is a story I have to tell you. I was at the gym, and a guy gave me this DVD called The Smashing Machine. And I took it home and I watched it, and it fascinated me, this particular guy called Mark Kerr. The next morning, I got woken up to a phone call from my agent in America saying, we've got an audition for you for a film called The Smashing Machine. And I could not believe that I had been given the video the night beforehand, and I was rung the next morning to say I was to audition for this film. It was crazy. The guy in question had used certain things to help him grow, to get big. And I had a friend who was Mr. Australia, who was a bouncer in the town that I came from Newcastle. Him and his brother were the big boys around town. And I went to him and I said, look, can you help me? I want this role. And so he helped me put on a lot of size. I got to 105 kilos. I'm 85 now. On Spartacus, I was like 88, 89. But I got to 105, I was huge. And I got this role, like, they were not going to give it to me. But anyway, I flew to South Africa, and Jean-Claude Van Damme was meant to play my coach in the film. And the day before filming was to start, or 2 days before filming was to start, he didn't show up. And the whole film fell over. And I'd spent every penny I had. And I had nothing left. And as, like an actor, you got to face rejection, but this one was a really big blow. I mean, I had worked for 3 months to get my body huge, and the whole thing felt like such a blow. I went back to Australia, and I, a friend of mine had a building company, and I said, I'm broke, mate. I'm totally broke. And he put me to work on this building site as a laborer, you know. So I'd pick up all the broken bricks and cart them up to the bins and whatnot, and dig a big hole. I was digging a swimming pool in the backyard. I was digging out this big hole, and my manager was ringing up going, Manu, are you still in the hole? She's German. I was like, yeah, it's getting deeper. And she said, and then she rang me up one day and she said, Manu, we've got this role for a new show called Spartacus. And when I went to walk in to do Spartacus, or the audition, there was all these 20-year-old, 19-year-old boys in the corridor waiting to go in. And at the time I was like 40. And the casting agent, who I knew, said to me, what are you doing here? And I said, I've come to audition for... And she said, Manu, this is like for 20-year-olds. They're looking... Because Spartacus and those characters back in the day were 20. But, you know, it's been a while since we've had a war, so, you know... So, you know, these young boys were in there, you know, going, you know, I am Spartacus. You know, and you know, whatever the reason was, but I think it was because they just wanted a deeper performance. They ended up going with Andy Whitfield, who was 36, and me, 40. But when I first went in, you know, I almost got completely put off the audition because she told me I was the wrong age for it. And I was like, oh, whatever. Okay, I'll just throw this one out there. But you know, in getting Spartacus, it was, you know, I really fought hard for that role because of what a big letdown it was not to do this movie, The Smashing Machine. I kind of had to reinvent my courage again to come through. But I remember training. I would get up every morning and go training. And I remember walking in and I saw the guy who plays Wolverine.
Hugh Jackman.
I came into the gym like the day after I landed Spartacus, and Hugh Jackman was walking out to go and film Wolverine. And so the next morning I arrived like at about 5:30 a.m. And I got there just as Hugh Jackman was arriving, and I said, okay, mate, if you can do this, I can do it as well. It was funny. We had this little exchange. And I put in so much physical work that when I got onto set to do Spartacus, you know, the stunt guys knew how prepped I was. And in New Zealand, you're allowed to do your own stunts to some degree. And so I did all of Spartacus. When I got to Canada to do Arrow, they had different regulations. And whenever they do anything dangerous, it's like, stop, okay, actors off, stunt guys on. And I didn't like that. That wasn't really good for the way I think. But you have to work with the system, you know, and that's the way their system was. So, you know, yeah. I'll tell you, you're looking for a blooper moment? On Shannara Chronicles, how young's the audience here? If there's anybody under the age of 18, just cover your ears in a second. When I was doing Shannara, there was one particular scene where as the druid, I come across the top of this mountain and the young prince is being killed by the Dagdamore, the evil guy. And as I get across the top of the hill, the action said that I thump the ground with my staff and it sends a shockwave, earthquake, and it puts a crack in the hole between the Dagdamore and the other guys. And there was no word, there was no dialogue there. And I said to the director, this just seems like a moment where he'd have to use a spell, he'd have to say something. And, you know, once you're on set and you're actually filming, it's hard to add lines or whatever without the consent of producers and whatnot. But the director was like, well, listen, I'm going to go over here and shoot something for 5 minutes. Why don't you come up with a line? And I couldn't think of anything. I was, the kind of speech they use is, I don't know, some sort of like Germanic kind of Latin kind of thing. But when he came back, I said, okay, I've thought of something. And he went, okay, go for it. And so I came up and I slammed my staff down to the ground and I went, Rakuf Rathom, like really loud, you know. Rakuf Rathom! And it was like, and he was like, brilliant. That was fantastic. And on the way home in the bus, he said, how did that line really worked well? What was it? And I said, it was Rakuf Rathom. And he said, how'd you come up with that? And I said, it's mother backwards. It was like I was too late. So in season two, I'm looking for the next opportunity to expand upon that. I definitely think that Crixus had the biggest story arc. You know, Crixus was like a beginning and an end. You know, very, very solid. I mean, I was very fortunate, even though it was only because of Andy's situation, but I was fortunate that when they had to fill in a space where Andy was getting treatment, they made Guards of the Arena, and that took everybody back to the beginning of Crixus's story. You know, and that would never have happened under different circumstances. So there was something about that allowed the audience to see the innocence of the character when he arrived, the same as Spartacus. You know, and then of course, you know, we went all the way to that wonderful death scene with Navia, you know, which was so wonderfully choreographed and thought out by the director to die in Navia's eye, you know, it was really poetic. So Crixus is definitely by far my favorite experience in taking a journey for a character. I think with Arrow, it's incomplete. I mean, for me, it feels... I feel dissatisfied. You know, the fans want more, you know, so there's this kind of like missing element to that story to give it some finality. I mean, working with Peter Jackson was obviously the biggest opportunity of my life in terms of, you know, it's probably one of the most watched movies on the planet. So to understand it, that you can get to be a part of that and to represent Tolkien, you know, and working with Peter Jackson was the most professional environment that I was ever in, and also the most technological, because I had to do motion capture, which is really like it's a new field, really. It's an old field for gaming. You know, gaming was using motion capture back with Street Fighter and all of these old video games, but when they started to use it for film now, there's a lot of scope. Motion capture will be used a lot in the future, but, you know, it's great for creature creation. But in order to become Azog, there were so many mental hurdles that I had to overcome. First of all, because the outfit that you put on is like a leotard. It's like a... Put, put up your hand if you know what the motion capture costume looks like. Yes, yeah, it's like those, the blue guys, or is it the blue guys that wear the body-tied outfits? You know, so I can imagine how, you know, the funny thing is as well is that I met Andy Serkis 1 year before I got Azog. I met him at the San Diego Comic-Con in America. And I sat down and we had a big conversation about motion capture. And I was talking to him about specifics. Like I saw him performing King Kong. And I said, you know, I really like this moment in King Kong where they came in very close to King Kong's eye. And King Kong was sitting there watching the sunset. And he ripped a tree out of the ground and was eating it like a celery stick. But as you came in on the eye, it was just kind of like... It was just this kind of... Like King Kong didn't have this freedom, this life. He was just restrained to this island as some sort of a lone figure, you know. And in the meantime, you know, the female actress starts to wake up in the background. Then all of a sudden it's like, you know, he turns around. But in this one moment, there's this little bit of humanity. And I said to Andy, I said, that I remember that moment in the film, like, you know, in the original King Kong, you'd never get that. In the original King Kong, the eyes just look like glass and it's like, you know. Now, the reason why Peter Jackson went for motion capture with Azog, and if you watch Azog specifically for his expressions, is because you could go right into him. And my eyes, you know, Peter said to me that he loved the way that I took the time. And the reason why I took time with Azog is because the night before going in to film with Peter Jackson for this, I was flown down. They only gave me the script at the hotel the night beforehand, and it was all in black speech, and I was really, you know, I couldn't learn that sort of speech overnight, so I had to have people hold it around the studio. So as I was walking, there'd be a guy over there holding one, and I'd go, "Umak de umnak," and then somebody would be over there, and I'd go, "Gunde nisi, gunde nas," you know. But then I had this tight bodysuit on, and if I walked like me, if I just walked like this, there was this big screen and it was showing like a semi-rendered version of Azog. But if I walked normally, Azog was so big, he was going like this. You have to inhabit the same amount of space that Arnold Schwarzenegger's body would use. So here I am in this tight bodysuit, but I have to sort of become Azog. So I had to sort of move, you know, with this sort of enlarged kind of performance. Also, you know, there was no other actors there. What had happened was they'd filmed the whole movie with a 7-foot guy, and then Peter Jackson wasn't happy with that performance, so he decided to do it in motion capture. So they'd filmed the whole movie. The whole movie was in the can. And they brought me in to do a new performance of a character that they were going to digitally put on top of the film, which had to, you know, which meant a lot of technical stuff, really. But I never worked with Richard Armitage. I never worked with any environment. I was sitting like on what was meant to be a wag, but it was like a gymnastics pole vault, you know, those, it was just like this. I was in a studio in a little tight suit, and I'm sitting like this, and Peter Jackson's saying, "You know the last scene of the first movie? Who's seen The Hobbit?" Okay, the last scene of the first movie is the big tree is in front and they're up the tree and I ride down on the wag. And can I get you to come up here? And you as well. You go on this side. Can you just move the chair as though it's rocking like a wag? So there's two guys in the studio moving this thing that I'm sitting on. This is me riding the wag. And Peter Jackson saying, "Okay, there's a giant tree in front of you." That's the fight of the weekend, though. It's like, "Why?" And Peter says, "Up in the tree is like Gandalf and you know, all the characters, you know. Say your first line." And my first line was, "Can you smell the fear?" Gunde nisi, gunde nas. And I said to Peter, "Peter, wait one second. What is this thing that I'm sitting on?" And he said, it's a giant wolf. It's called a warg. And I went, okay. Am I going to ride this thing like in the other two films as well? And he said, yeah. And I said, is it special? And he went, what do you mean? I said, well, I'm the king of the orcs. Do I have a special warg? You know, do I have a relationship with my warg? Because if I'm going to ride it for three films, maybe we should bring it into this, you know, maybe I should interact with it. And he said, oh, okay. And so I said, in this scene, instead of saying, can you smell the fear to the orcs that are around me, I get my hand cut off, don't I? I've got like a pitchfork on this arm. And he said, yeah, that's cut off by now. It gets cut off in an earlier scene in the movie. And I said, okay, so if this is a giant wolf and I'm its owner, then if it's like a dog, does it like the back of its neck getting scratched? And Peter walks out from behind his thing and he's just going, where are you going with this, you know? And I said, well, can I use the pitchfork and like scratch the back of its neck and then lean in? Where's its head? And he said, oh, it's got a giant head. It's out here somewhere. I'm sitting on something this big, getting pushed around by these guys, right? But its head is out here. So he goes, yeah, we'll give it a go. So as I come down, so we took had another take. So we're coming down.
Oi. Gundenisi, Gundenas.
And I've leaned out and I said it to the wolf. Just watch that scene on the movie and see how different it makes the tone. And it takes you away from this idea that this is an evil thing. All of a sudden, Azog becomes kind of sensitive and connected to another animal. And it just creates a different sort of layer. And out of all the acting choices I think I've ever done, for some very, very strange reason, that's one of my proudest choices I've made as an actor. Because it took away this two dimensions of a character and it created this depth of connection and relationship. Thanks, guys. Thanks for bouncing around, dude. Like Star Wars, you know, like probably one of the most progressive stories in fantasy ever told that based itself upon, you know, our civilization and the stars. And I remember as a child seeing that film and just being really blown away. And you know, like Chewbacca is like a Azog or something. You know, I mean, these fantastical characters still have a basis of performance that make them, give them qualities. So, you know, if you're in that fantasy realm playing something that's unreal, you still tie it back into what the metaphors and themes are from, you know, a human telling perspective. So for me, I really like Al-Anon as a character. And I hope they really push him to the limit this season. You know, the first season I was a little bit like the guide. You know, I'd come in and say the big, you know, the hard speech, but then I'd send the young guys off. So I was really just sort of pointing them in directions. There was some stuff that he struggled with, but I've got a feeling that the writers and the producers are gonna push Alan on this season, and I'm looking forward to that. You know, I look forward to those journeys. You know, especially if they're consequential. You know, I don't think I have a preference. You know, I mean, listen, there's some really garbage writing, and there's some great writing. There's some great directing. There's some great crews that you'll work with. And it's all teamwork, you know. But when the magic of a really good story comes together and you know you're with the right people, it's quite amazing what happens there on a set. You know, you know it. You know it at the time that it's happening. And then other times you'll sit there and go like, my God, what did I get myself into? You know, I'm not going to name specifics, but it can happen. You know, budgets. I mean, stories can have an incredible intention and still get screwed up in the production phases, you know. Or egos can get in the way and stuff like that. But you know, you can't stop a good idea.